All of this has the intention of reducing, you know, surface congestion, streamlining better traffic in the region. There's a whole bunch of safety objectives. Brian's going to get into that in one sec. So I'll quickly introduce the three individual speakers. I'm really just here to provide an introduction. The first speaker we're going to have is Mr. Brian Hoeft, who's the director of FAST at the Regional Transportation Commission of Southern Nevada. Again, we had a couple shout-outs to Brian in the keynotes yesterday. He's essentially responsible for running a lot of the traffic signal operations in the southern part of the state, with a major focus, obviously, on Las Vegas. So he's going to kick things off here. I believe then we're going to hand it over to Ian. So Ian is with an amazing partner of ours called Waycare. He'll tell you a little bit about what exactly they do. They're an instrumental piece to everything Brian is doing at RTC, and again, an integrated partner to ours. So I guess Daniel Lewis is the final speaker. Daniel is kind of a rock star in the data science department. He's the chief architect behind the large majority, if not all, of the traffic signal analytics and things like that that we're doing. He's obviously working directly in partnership with Waycare and RTC to do that. So again, we're really excited about this session because, you know, for Geotab, certainly it sets a bit of a benchmark in terms of smart cities and data science and things like that. I'm going to turn it over to Brian. What I'll ask is that, if it's okay, how do you guys want to handle questions? We can do them live or we can hold them till the end.
Life's fine. Either way, life's good.
If you got to ask a question.
Okay, so what I'll do is, after I hand things over to Brian here, I'll hang it out at the front. If anyone's got a question, or maybe I'll hang it out at the back so I can see arms. Anyone got a question, just put your arm up, and I'll walk the mic over, and we can just ask questions live. Okay, over to you, Brian.
All right. Thank you very much, and welcome, everyone. And I am very excited to talk about this because, as John mentioned, I'm basically a traffic engineer, and traffic engineers have been doing traffic signal operations, freeway operations, the same old way for decades and decades, which means they've been using the lack of data that's been in place to make their decisions. But now we have this great opportunity to work with this data and to not really invest anything in infrastructure, to just take what's in place, kind of corral everything and do this. So it's early on, it's in its development, it's very thought-provoking, but it can pay off on a lot of things. So again, I run our traffic management center. Every big city has a traffic management center where you'll have a wall of video images and you'll have people at desks doing all their different stuff. And so that's what I head up in Las Vegas. The goals that we have are to make sure that our transportation system is as safe as possible, and we want it to be as efficient and optimized as possible. We want your trip to be reliable. That doesn't mean that you're not going to have congestion delays here and there, but we want it to be reliable as much as possible. And then as this data is coming in, we want to be able to have it define and kind of diagnose what needs to be done, what can be done, and also give us some parameters, some benchmarks for performance. So some of the things that we're doing with this data and how it started with us in Las Vegas is, as mentioned, we got a rock star data scientist up here. I have a rock star data scientist traffic engineer who developed an app and did a lot of work so that we had a place for this data to land. So basically what happens, whether it's a Geotab device or an app that we developed internally, we get the second by second breadcrumb of the trip, and then we can overlay it on the traffic network. So we can overlay it onto the traffic signals. Right there, that tells us what's happening. When I drove through a signal, did I stop or did I not stop? What we've done, especially since bringing in the Geotab data in October of 2018, is we've now worked with over 6 million records of what happens at a traffic signal somewhere in Las Vegas, somewhere throughout the day. We have about 1,500 traffic signals, and 6 million is a big number for humans, but it's a small number in the data world. But it's also a big enough number for us to get some good traction and develop some good trends. So what we're able to tell with the 14 months worth of data that we've analyzed so far is that if you're driving through a traffic signal, and we're using the equivalent of about 300 vehicles, and again, there's millions of vehicles out there, st- Statistically, that may not seem like it's going to be enough of a sample size, but when we've looked at the data, it is telling us consistent stories. It's telling stories to us, the traffic professionals, that make intuitive sense. But what we're seeing is 57 to 58% of the time, those 6 million trips going through a traffic signal somewhere did not stop. So you got the green light. And then when we look at a trip down a corridor, let's say that here on San Diego, I was leaving the convention center and I was going to drive up to the airport, and I might have 10 signals that I have to go through. We're tracking what happens on specific trips along arterials. So we see average speeds of 23 miles an hour if you look at every single trip that we track. But if you look at trips on specific types of roadways, if you look at performance of specific types of intersections, you're seeing how it changes as well. In Las Vegas, we're very much reliant on this grid system where we have major arterials, north, south, east, west, at a mile spacing. So when those intersections cross, those are two major streets crossing together, we're not going to get that 58% green light. We're going to get maybe 38% on average. But we can also take the performance and we can rank it. So I can take all my major intersections and I can rank them and say, okay, here was the top 20. Some of these intersections are getting 60 to 70% green lights. Here are the ones that bottom out. They're only getting 20% green lights. Now we can go in and say, what should we do? Should I change the signal timing? Am I losing performance because I could add a turn lane? Is there a lot of pedestrian activity that's going on? And obviously we need to take care of the peds, but we can start to understand more effectively with data that is close to free on what's going on. So we're diving into this quite aggressively. And as you can see on here, these are some of the things that we're looking at. So this is a map of a corridor that we've been looking at in collaboration with Geotab and others, just to flesh out more and more of these details. It's the Cheyenne corridor. It's north of downtown Las Vegas in the Strip. You can see the two diagonal streets on either side. They kind of converge into where you would be getting into downtown Las Vegas. And then North Las Vegas has its own airport. You can see it there. This is a corridor that is sort of a commuter corridor, but at the same time, because it's not going into the core of the city, and it's also by an airport, there's a lot of heavy vehicle traffic as well. So you're going to see a real cool insight that we've been able to derive from the data. So I have three more slides that kind of get into the weeds of what's going on, but there's a whole bunch of stuff that's been left off. So depending on where you are, what you do, I'm certainly interested in having conversations to get your insights on this as well. But here's three specific examples. What a typical traffic engineer would do is, let's try to line up the lights so that we can get green lights as much as possible. And they would more than likely use an average vehicle, your average sedan, your average SUV. But what about in a corridor like this where you have a relatively high percentage of heavy vehicles? So what you can see with the blue bars is those are the heavy vehicles, and they travel at lower speeds than the lighter vehicles do. We've also made some determinations that there's going to be a lot of that heavy vehicle activity in the middle of the day outside of the peak period. So in theory, what you could do here is we could design some signal timing to cover the lighter vehicles in the morning and the afternoon, and then we could swap things around to better accommodate the speeds of the heavier vehicles, and then everybody wins. It's safer, there's less emissions, there's less delay. And so here's another example of what traffic engineers do. They'll make this speed flow diagram. So you can see generic intersections 1 through 4. And if those lines are traveling diagonally, that means the vehicle is moving in space from destination 1 all the way down to destination 4. When the line is horizontal, that means the vehicle is stopped. And then you can also see the Christmas colors there. If that's a green bar, that means that vehicle has a green light. If there's a red bar, that means that vehicle has a red light. And then the blue line and the green line, you can see how the signals could be adjusted potentially to make it better for the heavier vehicle. So these are the types of insights that we're starting to get. And it's not just the relatively small sample size I'm working with. Now we're starting to bring in tens of thousands of vehicles, millions, if not more, of records. So it's not something that we're going to be able to crank out on the spreadsheets and the databases and everything like that. That's one of the big kind of transition points we're in right now. As more of this data comes in, how do we grapple, how do we manage it, how do we get it so that it can tell us the most important stories so we can take the most effective actions? And then this is an example of an internal tool that we developed at our department. And again, you can see what I'll call are these trajectories. So you could go in to a corridor and you could say, let me look at the last 3 months worth of data. Let me look at this from Rancho Drive to Martin Luther King Drive. And again, if you're going diagonal on that graph, you're traveling, so you can kind of see where a consistent stop is. We got a consistent stop there at, this is either blurry or my eyes are failing me or both. I think it might be Simmons, but you can see that, and maybe that's what we want to do. We know that to get two-way progression, to take care of the cross street, we're gonna have to program in some stops, but we want the data to quantify for us what's going on. So that's the perspective from the government agency, traffic management center, from a center and a region that is very innovative with data. It's very exciting for us, but there's a lot of challenges, but a lot of opportunities. And so now I get to turn it over to Ian to tell, have him explain how he's helping with everything.
Thanks, Brian. Morning, everybody. Still just about morning, but feels later. My company is headquartered in Israel, which means my days start really, really early. So it's kind of towards the end of my day right about now. So Waycare is an AI platform that attempts to identify insights around traffic. And insights range widely from we try to identify congestion that shouldn't be there. We try to identify high-risk areas for crashes. That's sort of one of the more highly publicized things we do. So we predict that there's likely to be a crash in a particular area. It actually Vegas makes for great demos for that stuff, by the way, because there's a pretty high volume of incidents. So we'll show on the Southern Beltway a like bright red line showing, hey, there's a high crash risk here. And then at some point through the demo, we can be pretty much guaranteed that an incident will pop up there. We just hope that it's nothing too serious, because it's never good to pop up the cameras and see something bad on the screen. So we try to avoid that. But by predicting where things occur, we allow the various agencies involved to take proactive steps to prevent them. So crashes, particularly the easiest, although far and away the least sophisticated way of preventing a crash is to slow down traffic. And the best way to do that is to stick a police car at the side of the road with the blue lights flashing. We all ignore speed limits. I certainly do. Anyone who pretends not to is probably not telling the truth. In fact, I got myself a nice performance award from the California Highway Patrol just a couple of months ago. Comes on a nice little yellow certificate with a date where they'll give it to you in the court. It was lovely. So you have to slow traffic down to prevent accidents. There are not sufficient police resources to put a police car with blue lights flashing on every single road everywhere in a city. So you need to know where and when to put them. And so we help predict where that's going to happen. We do that in kind of an interesting way. So we take a lot of data from a lot of different sources. Geotab is one of the data sources we use. We classify Geotab as a connected vehicle data source. We also connect to a lot of city infrastructure. So Brian didn't really talk very much about the fact that he's also responsible for all the stuff in Southern Nevada, all the in-ground sensors that do things like speed measurement and all of that kind of stuff. Which are interesting, right? Because you start thinking about one of the major differences between connected vehicle data and in-ground sensors is perspective. So a speed sensor tells you the speed from the perspective of the road, whereas in-vehicle data tells you what the vehicle's doing from the perspective of the vehicle itself, which really is much more interesting. So you can start getting a lot more data about intersections. Think in terms of where is someone turning? How does green light performance vary if you're making a left turn versus a right turn versus going straight ahead? And even simple things from the perspective of a single traffic light in a corridor, it may be that the driver met that light on green, but perhaps they'd already stopped five times in the run-up to that light. So much, much less, there's a lot more data that you can get out of connected vehicle stuff. So the way our platform works, we basically take in streams of data from all sorts of different sources. We flow all of that data in essentially into a data lake, but on the way into that, we have a whole bunch of AI algorithms which sit there in all sorts of different technologies. There are neural networks, there's basic algorithmic stuff, all sorts of things going on, attempting to identify various different things. So one thing, it would be incident identification. So we try to identify a crash, and we get a data source from a police CAD system. That's pretty reliable, generally. When the police system says there's a crash, it's quite likely there really is. It may not be where it thought it was, because often that's coming from a human calling in with the phone, and they're pretty bad at that stuff. We may get indication of a crash coming in from Waze. We get a giant data feed from Waze. That's pretty unreliable. Humans are very bad at where they push the button on Waze, or whether they push the button on Waze, or randomly deciding to push the button on Waze. In fact, the Nevada Highway Patrol motorcycle cops continually drive down the road putting the police officer, police officer, police officer button on Waze. That's their countermeasure for the fact that people report where they are, so they figure they'll just report that they're everywhere all the time. But Waze is generally kind of unreliable, right? So location's not great. Accuracy of what the incident type is not great. But it's a data source. Connected vehicle data is very accurate for what it is. And Brian mentioned already that it seems like a small amount of data doesn't necessarily give you great fidelity. But actually, statistically, you really need two data points to confirm each other, and then you can be reasonably confident that you're dealing with something quite accurate. So we think of connected vehicle data, like Geotab, as being virtual sensors. So instead of having a freeway sensor telling you how fast a car's going, you have virtual sensors all over the place. Makes a huge difference in your ability to instrument arterials versus freeways. Freeways tend to have pretty good speed data. Arterials have almost none. So that ability to determine that data from connected, get sensor data essentially from connected vehicles is pretty huge. There are limitations. Geotab particularly is very strong in government vehicles, which means it's pretty good from sort of 7 a.m. until 5 p.m. It's not great outside those windows. It's not great on weekends. But there are other sources that do that stuff. What Geotab does give you is very, very good fidelity in that in those time windows when the government vehicles are active. So what we do is we take all of that data, we flow it together, and we use it to kind of cross-correlate. So if we see a report on Waze that there's a crash on an arterial blocking a lane, but we see no variance in speed, we're going to substantially downgrade the likelihood of that Waze report being real. Likewise, if we suddenly see massive changes in speed on an arterial, we can probably assume that there's something going on. And because AI, neural networks are pretty good at figuring stuff out that humans aren't necessarily all that good at in terms of pattern recognition, we'll very quickly start identifying, well, okay, based on the type of braking patterns we're seeing, that's a crash versus a pothole versus a car stopped at the side of the road. And so that kind of stuff gets surfaced out. One of the main things that Waycare's doing is doing all of this in real time. So we provide a web-based UI that sits on the desktops of all of the folks in the traffic management center, which, by the way, is a super cool room in Vegas, giant room, about this size, in fact, with a wall that's just all screens. Right side is 911 dispatch, left side is the traffic management folks and the maintenance folks. So they all have 7 to 10 displays on their desks, one of which is dedicated to Waycare. It's kind of cool stuff. And so on that display for Waycare, we'll be popping up incidents coming in from all these different sources, validated and verified, cross-checked with various different data sources. One of the things that we've been working on extensively with Brian and Daniel is specific reporting around intersection performance, but we're doing a lot more with the data than just the intersection performance stuff. Starting to look at a really interesting insight classification of a near miss. It's really interesting to see crashes, but it's much more valuable if you can see a crash before it occurs, or a likely crash before it occurs, so you can prevent it. So we're starting to generate those kind of insights in real time, and then with a whole bunch of historical reporting wrapped on the back of that. That's actually, as Brian said, slightly blurry screenshot of our UI. The UI is not intentionally blurry. That's the screenshot in this case. And this is showing a similar view to what Brian presented. It's kind of hard to see, but there are traffic signals along a corridor there, and we are showing on the right-hand side the corridor performance and how what each of the lights looks like. And we've actually taken it quite a bit further since this, and we sort of demonstrated some stuff. That was CES was last week, right? Yeah, just last week at CES we demonstrated a bunch of stuff around what we're doing with the Geotab data for intersection performance. Some pretty cool stuff. I could spend a whole bunch of time talking in a great deal of detail about the data science behind it, but then Daniel would get really pissed off, and I don't want to do that. So I'm going to hand it over to Daniel to cover that data science side of intersection performance with Geotab data. So thanks.
Thank you. Question? Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh. Yeah, perfect. So that was super. Like, I'm really impressed with that. It was like very. I really enjoyed the presentation. So, but one quick question. You just kind of alluded to it. Was that the near miss?
Uh-huh.
Can you give us a little more background on how you determine what a near miss accident is? Like, what parameters are you putting?
Yeah. That's a great question. Basically. It's going to sound super flip, but a near miss is anything that's not a hit. So heavy braking with no incident involved, essentially. So we look for heavy braking, or in some cases, some of the data providers, we get lateral acceleration. So we get swerving, we get harsh braking. Even acceleration data is kind of interesting. So when you see a whole bunch of that, and you're not able to cross-correlate that with an incident, that qualifies as a near miss. So essentially, we see everything as a near miss until it's a hit. But what that means is that when we start seeing all the near miss data, we can identify, oh, there's something going on over here. We've got a lot happening. And we can then do things like change dynamic speed limits, light up the DMS signs on the freeway, warn people to slow down. Assuming they're not like me and they don't just ignore all that stuff, then you should be able to improve the safety of the roadway before the actual accident occurs. So let's take an example, the usual cruising along the freeway, checking your phone or texting your wife, and you look up and, oh my God, the car's in front of you stopped. You hammer on your brakes and platooning occurs, right? That's the effect when all the cars behind you start to slow down dramatically. Now, assuming that you haven't been a complete idiot and not looked up until you hit the back of the car in front of you, then you've just created a near miss, and you hope that the people behind you are also paying attention, and so it remains a near miss. But that has a really long-term effect. You get substantial platooning on a super busy freeway. That can last a really long time, like hours, potentially. And so being able to slow down the incoming traffic into that area and take dynamic action can really pay off. Plus, you can look at it historically and say, okay, what areas do we see a lot of harsh braking behavior, a lot of near misses, essentially, and what infrastructure steps can we take to avoid those? Do we need better signage? Do we even maybe need to think about changing roadway layout? There's a lot of actions you can take based on that near miss. But fundamentally, near miss is events occurring that are not leading to an actual crash. Of course, around an actual crash, you get a whole bunch more near misses in the backup to that. Because once there's been a crash, everyone stops and stares and continues to brake as they get by it. So we see all of that and are able to start to analyze that and put it into various different classifications. That answer the question?
Cool. All right. I'm also happy to share the data science discussions with Ian here. So I'm just going to talk specifically about some of the data science work that goes on at Geotab to generate these insights for Brian and other cities as well. And yeah, feel free to jump in with questions at any point during this. I just want to give you sort of a high-level overview of some of the methodologies that we're using to go from this raw telematics data into actually useful insights that you can be making proactive changes based on. And so what we want to do is we're starting with just telematics data. Basically, we have, you know, points on a map and some associated speeds and other metrics, and we need to go from that somehow to generating intersection insights. And sometimes we get to start with geospatial data or information about how the road network looks or how it's laid out, the width of streets, where intersections are, et cetera, but often not. And if I'm going into a new place and maybe doesn't have some of this infrastructure set up, maybe they don't have CCTVs yet, they don't have road sensors, they don't have geography files for how the city's laid out, I need to go from just Geotab's raw data into some sort of road network that I can then use to start aggregating all of this GPS and speed information into generating these insights. And so that's basically a machine learning problem. There's no way as a human I can go in through these hundreds of streets and thousands of intersections and generate these geography objects easily in a scalable way, you know, across all of North America. So we treat this as a supervised machine learning problem. And so the world is divided up into, we use geohashes, but there's various other methods for splicing up the world. These are geohash size 9. They're basically a couple meters by a couple meters. And each of the blue dots that you see on the left there are where we observed, you know, some number of vehicles. And you can see that a lot of those cover the roads and intersections, and this is just a particular slice of downtown Oakville. A lot of them are in parking lots. Some of them are over top of buildings. You know, GPS isn't always 100% accurate. Sometimes people are parking on the side of the road, et cetera. So I need to somehow go from this into a series of geohashes or squares or points that actually represent the underlying road network. And so on the right is a tool that we built internally to do this, where we're looking at this, and we would typically use, you know, satellite view and augment that with additional information about the most up-to-date information we have on the road network. And then I'll start labeling points. Those green points lie on the road, and maybe I'll label some other points that are at the center of the intersection, and some red points that are either in parking lots or side roads or the side of the building. And what we want to do then is train an algorithm, and there's a whole bunch of features associated with these points based on the vehicles that are going through and the patterns of driving behavior that they're exhibiting, so that the model that we have can learn to classify these points into being part of the road network or not part of the road network. And so what we end up with is a plot that looks like something on the right there. So the machine learning model has learned to identify, of all of these points that these vehicles are driving through, which ones are actually part of the road network, which ones are actually part of intersections, and which ones are not. And so all the red points there have been identified as being part of the core road network that feeds into all of those intersections in that particular part of Oakville. And so once we have that, now we can start thinking about how we're going to track vehicle movements through these little clustered points and start generating these insights that Brian can actually take advantage of. So we start by creating an intersection core. So now I have all these little cubes, and I get the location of the intersections either from the city itself or from OSM or other locations, at least as a starting point. And OSM actually doesn't have the concept of an intersection, but it has things like traffic signals, and those can be clustered together to identify the center of intersections. And from there, we can build out a core of an intersection that starts from the intersection of all of these ways and then goes into each of the arterials that feed into that intersection. And then we're going to cut out the center, and we're going to start with these little centroids around each of the entryways into that intersection. And so from there, we're going to then start to use our aggregated vehicle data to create pathways through that intersection so that we can start tracking where people are coming from as they enter that intersection and where they're going to. In this place, in this particular example here, it's a simple, you know, perpendicular crosswise between two streets. So I've got four possible entry and exit points, and maybe you can do left turns in some of these, maybe you can't. But basically, I start to aggregate all of our thousands and thousands of trips into these little clustered groups of geohashes that I've created and look at their bearings as they're entering the intersection. And they're colored here based on the aggregate, you know, mean or average or mode bearing here. And then I start to see, you know, very obvious traversals or pathways through this intersection. As you come in from, you know, 1, 2, or 4, you've got, you know, particular orientation. And then as you pass through the intersection, you know, parallel to 3 in the crosswise direction, that bearing continues. And I can start to build up these pathways of the possible valid ways that vehicles can enter and exit through these intersections. So we assign these first few geohashes to the closest cluster, 1, 2, 3, or 4, find the mode of the bearing, throw out all of the vehicles that are going in a different direction. For example, on number 3 there, if I'm going like 270 degree bearing heading west, you know, if I have a vehicle in one of those geohashes, which is at 360 degrees, it means he's probably turning right into a parking lot if 90% of the other vehicles are at around 270 degree bearing. So I can throw those out and start to figure out what the mode is and iteratively do that building backwards and keep repeating this and repeating this across all the intersections in the city. And then what we end up with is something like this, which is all of the possible roads that feed into given intersections, and that gets spread out and done iteratively and recursively across the whole city until we have the road network. And so once we have kind of these pathways into an intersection and the concept of a core that a vehicle is actually passing through, now we can monitor all of the statistics about all of these pathways as you get to the intersection and kind of time mark them and categorize them when you pass through that core. So this might be an example of a possible traversal through that intersection. So let's say those streets extend further back onto the page. I've got our raw GPS points, you know, 1 through 11 here, and I start tracking, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And so let's say as I'm driving through, you know, I had to stop at point number 2. That becomes our first stop on approach to the intersection. I pass through, and then at point 8 here, you've now left the center of the intersection. That ends the trip. And point 9 would be in a trace, you know, that then feeds into the next intersection. And so over the course of the day, as you're driving through the city, we break everything up into trips defined by, you know, you passing through these intersection cores and then backwards in times the metrics and the information about the trips that led to that intersection, such as the average speed, the number of times you had to stop, all of that kind of thing. And because we've got so many vehicles driving around all the time, all of these sensors, we start to build up, you know, tens, hundreds, thousands, sometimes 10,000 trips over the course of, you know, weeks to months. And we can start to really drill down and get some really interesting insights about the behavior of vehicles historically in these intersections. And then you can do things like maybe change the signal timing, and then over the course of a few weeks, generate a few thousand more trips and look at how those changes are impacting congestion in that particular spot and how that change propagates throughout the city. And so once we've defined those intersections, we can now do things like track these individual trips. And you can see just an example near our headquarters in Oakville there of individual, you know, vehicles passing through these intersections. And you can see, you know, in the top there, we've got blue for that particular intersection. As vehicles are heading southwest, as they pass through that core, you see the trips change to red because now they're counting towards trips that are going into that next intersection. And this is just a view of what's happening, you know, over the course of days over the entire city. And you have thousands and thousands of these trips going through, you know, your thousand plus intersections in a city like Las Vegas. And that gets aggregated up into each of these colored zones to provide information and metrics about those regions. So then we can start to really drill down and do some sort of historical analysis and insights at an individual intersection level to say things about the performance of that, and maybe try to optimize it further and reduce congestion. So we can pull out all sorts of interesting metrics, one of which is the number of stops to clear an intersection. We can do things like the average travel time, the queue length, all sorts of things like that. And when we look at, you know, a heat map like this, so this is the Cheyenne corridor that Brian was talking about, in particular the east side of it, Losee Road coming off of the freeway there, I believe. And you can look at, in this plot, we're looking at the number of stops to clear an intersection. For the most part, most times of day, we've actually got pretty good coverage on this particular intersection, even at night. Most of them are one or less stops to clear the intersection. So for the most part, you're either getting a green light or you're only having to wait one light cycle to pass through the intersection. But we can see at the bottom of the plot there, entering on Losee Road heading southwest and then exiting on Cheyenne Avenue heading east. So you're coming south off of the highway and you're having to make a left turn onto Cheyenne Avenue. And we can see that on average, people are having to wait more than one stop to clear the intersection. So there's probably significant enough congestion that you're not able to clear the entire queue through one light cycle. And if we look into this particular data here, we can look at the average distance from the first stop to the light. And then if you look on Google Maps, you actually see that that average distance is longer than the length of the left turning lane. And so some of the traffic is probably backing up into a through lane and causing a little bit of congestion. But of course, if you were to extend the green light for left turns, that time's got to come from somewhere, so there's always going to be these trade-offs. But these types of plots allow you to kind of understand at least what's happening and try to optimize it a little bit further. And so something else that we've started to add now is building up graph networks of the city. So when we're trying to go from our raw telematics data to do things like corridor insights, we need to know what all the possible valid traversals are throughout the city. And so we take our data and kind of like the point clouds of connected intersections and start to build up an array of like possible paths that you can go through this city. And then based on our vehicle trip and traversals through these intersections, we can say, oh, you went through these particular intersections in sequence. And then we can further roll up that aggregation at that corridor level and start to generate some really unique insights. Because often, you know, as Brian has attested to, a lot of these optimizations happen through particular arterial throughways. And you don't want to necessarily optimize just in one intersection, but clear people through a sequence of green lights and get them through in waves. So once we've built up this graph network, that allows us to generate these plots that Brian was showing, where we do corridor insights across many intersections. But due to the volume of vehicles that we have, we can start to generate these plots from thousands and thousands of trips and get a really clear idea of the pattern of vehicle behavior through them. And you know, this might be by design, it might not. We can see that a lot of people are stopping at Losee Road here before they go to Donovan Way, whereas most of the rest of the trip through these particular three intersections is pretty fast without stopping. But once we've built up these tools, it really allows you to splice and carve the data up into really interesting ways and generate insights, you know, from a historical perspective and then be proactive about going forward and making these changes. But the volume of data that we're dealing with, we're able to do some really, really cool things. And then ultimately, you can also look at this at a citywide level. So these are particular animated plots, which are not currently animating, about average wait time at each of these intersections through the course of the day. This would have been very cool showing you over the 24 hours congestion starting in downtown Toronto and then propagating, but you'll have to use your imagination on that. So thank you very much.
Okay, yeah, that was so, I mean, I've said it many times before, that was super impressive. Does anyone have any questions? If not, I have there's one over here.
So the information that you're gathering, how are you guys incorporating this with first responders, ambulance, fire trucks, and things like that?
Probably a question for you guys.
Okay, so how are first responders taking advantage of this type of data? Is that correct? Yeah, the CAD system. So part of what we do in our traffic management center, as Ian described and I can describe as well, is we're co-located with the traffic engineers, the maintenance people, but also the dispatchers, the first responders, the people talking with the folks out in the street. So when we get that incident insight from WayCare, and then we confirm that there is an actual incident, and we do that confirming with the cameras, but we also collect these camera images, everything gets pushed out to the first responders out in the street, whether it's the tow truck drivers, the highway patrol, the freeway service patrol. They're going to get the same information that normally they get verbally. Now they're getting it descriptively. They're getting it 10 or more minutes more quickly, and then that allows their response to be much more effective. We can get the travel lanes cleared. We can get things pushed to the shoulder or completely off of the roadway. And then, as you've seen with the data, we can analyze all this. One of the big performance indicators is secondary crash. So let's say you're driving down the freeway, we have a crash, all the delays start to occur. As long as there's that exposure and the delay is occurring, there's the likelihood of vehicles, as that queuing develops, to crash there. That's what's known as a secondary crash. So as we've looked at the data, we're seeing the reduction in the secondary crashes, we're seeing better reliability and efficiency, so we're checking all the boxes of safety and efficiency. But the data here, to show it on the screens, put it in tables, that sort of thing, that's fine. That works, you know, maybe in a conference talk. But what we have been very aggressive about is pushing that out so that it becomes actionable, and then measuring the performance metrics, and then even making corrections. Let's say we had a big crash, and it took 2 hours to clear. We found out why there were delays. Maybe the next time a similar crash occurs, it only takes an hour to occur, and then we have all the associated metrics as well. So as long as this data becomes actionable and shared with all the partners, all the actors, so to speak, that's the beauty of it.
So there are a couple of interesting use cases with our platform specifically for first responders. So we're not just deployed in the TMC, we're also deployed as a tablet app inside. Did I just lose my mic?
Oh,
I'm still there.
No, you're still good.
We're also deployed as a tablet app inside Nevada Highway Patrol, City of Henderson Fire, City of Henderson Police Department, Freeway Service Patrol, City Maintenance Trucks. So one of the use cases that gets super interesting is you're a police officer on the side of the road. You get an inbound CAD dispatch saying, hey, there's a crash here, go deal with it. Before just driving straight to the location CAD tells, you can pull up the WayCare UI and look at the cameras and say, oh, okay, well, I was told that this crash was just downstream of the low C on-ramp to the 15. It's actually upstream. So if I'd taken the original path I was going to take, I'd have come onto the freeway too late, and I'd have had to have driven down an exit, looped around, and come back to it. It's going to cost me a whole bunch of extra time to get there. So we just provide that sort of direct user location precision. But also, because the TMC is directly engaged in all of these incidents, we have accurate location information for connected vehicle. We'll see the incident come in from Spillman or whatever the CAD system may be. The TMC will be able to update the location, and that will then get pushed back into Spillman to change the location in the CAD system. So the NHP or whatever officer they may be will have a real-time update to the location of the incident in their dispatch system, as well as being able to see all the city cameras and everything through our platform.
One thing I'd be curious, great presentation, thanks. One thing I'd be curious about is for the telematics data that is coming to these various platforms, is it coming from city vehicles that have this, or is it coming from Geotab's big data set for any vehicle that they're tracking that passes through the Las Vegas area? Where are you getting that telematics data from in the platform?
Yes, the telematics data is coming from both of those sources, basically. So yeah, the city vehicles themselves are going to be providing all that data, but also the Geotab platform, so aggregated, anonymized, and then, you know, grouped over time and to make sure it's privacy compliant. So all of the vehicles that have opted into the big data platform, that vehicle cool information gets aggregated up and combined with the city data as well. So these insights are coming not just from the municipal vehicles, but from all the vehicles that are passing through that have opted into the big data platform.
Let me just add on a little bit. Where we got our start from the traffic engineering perspective is that we first started with some locally generated data through an app that we developed, but then we tapped into the Geotab data, which gave us access to more than 200 vehicles. And so that gave us a significant enough sample size to get some of the metrics that I described, but it also kept the data at a manageable level so that those with the traffic engineering insights could work with the data. And then now we can kind of scale out with the increased amount of data. We've kind of done our first round of work to make it usable from the traffic engineering perspective, and now we're able to take in more and more data, but we've already designed some of the first algorithms that make it operational for us.
And we get data from all sorts of different sources. So, I mean, our start was Waze, the big old pipe from Waze, but we also have data from OEMs, direct in some cases, from some aggregators in other cases. So we're taking in a vast amount of data and processing it in some mammoth Amazon Kinesis streams at the moment.
Okay, so you got a question? Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I think we got another like 5-10 minutes.
Hey guys, Dave Bronstein with Together for Safer Roads. So have you done anything to change the built environment as a result of your partnership yet? Any real engineering changes, or is this mostly about traffic flows and signal timing and things like that?
So when you say built environment, like add capacity, make that those type of decisions?
Yeah, change the engineering, the concrete and whatnot.
Right. Right now, built environment, not so much, especially since I'm using it and I'm a traffic operator. So it's kind of like a poker hand. I'm going to play the cards I'm dealt and do what I can, but we are talking with our partners who are involved in those built environment decisions. I think some of the early smaller scale built things that we would do is add a right turn lane. Let's say that we just have this significant backing up. You got so many people who want to turn right, they don't have their own lane, and then you have a lot of heads who are crossing at the same time. If we could find a way to maybe prioritize the top 10 locations in need of that sort of treatment, then, and let's say we have a limited pot of money, then this is an example of how the data could be used to make those types of decisions. And then you could build off of that as you get into the bigger scale types of decisions.
Waker identified 6 key locations for deploying police officers. You can't just park your car at the side of the road. It's not that simple, right? So we recommended locations where Nevada DOT could build raised platforms at the side of the road, both for officer safety and better visibility. So those, they're called STMS sites, strategic traffic management sites. So have been 6 of them have been built so far, and there are a few more in progress. So those were funded by NDOT and built on recommendation AI platform.
Right. So what's nice about that, real quick, is that you had a major slowdown on the freeway at this certain location. So when you got the people coming to that slowdown at 70 miles an hour, there's obviously the increased likelihood of crashes. So we make the platform, we also post some messages on our large electronic signs. The combination of that information to the travelers actually worked. And then getting the data in real time or near real time, it told us that when we activated the messages, posted the patrol car there, 90% of the vehicles started traveling at the posted speed. And then we compared the 3 months of that test with the previous 3 months of crashes and incidents. We also saw a significant reduction there. So it's always important to build the roadways, have the capacity, have the lanes. What we're doing now is making sure that huge investment of infrastructure is being operated as safely and efficiently as possible. And usually in the culture of transportation infrastructure, that's kind of the forgotten part. You design it, you build it, but then the O and the M, the operation and maintenance, kind of gets, oh yeah, that'll get taken care of. Now we're demonstrating that, yes, we are actually taking care of it and giving you that much more bang for your buck. Looks like they're playing us off with the monitor.
So I've actually got just one final question. So given that it's still kind of early days with, I think, the partnership, we're really just, I think, scratching the surface, right, in terms of what we can do with this. But Maybe for all three of you, what are we expecting to see? I don't even know if there's an answer at this point, but what are we expecting to see in terms of improvements? Like, is there any knowledge of, you know, if I better, for example, coordinate my signals across the whole network, I expect to see an X percent reduction in travel times? Or is there any, like, do metrics like that exist today, or is this kind of so new and innovative, we'll be learning on the fly?
Yeah, let me start with that, because I alluded early in my discussion that the transportation professional community has their standard metrics. They use something called level of service, A through E or A through F, and it's kind of a aggregation of different measures. But how would you normally collect data about vehicles and performance? It's going to be more than likely human-based. It might be somebody driving in a car with a stopwatch. It may be somebody standing on a bridge counting cars. You know, we can automate that a little bit with devices, but it's still very labor-intensive. It doesn't give you the sample sizes that you need. So now that I've started to present some of these metrics, like 58% no stops or 23 miles an hour, the first question that comes out of most of the traffic engineers' mouth is, well, is that good? What does that mean? Because we've never had that type of metric. But now that we've been working with data for over a year, we're starting to see month-over-month comparisons. We're starting to see various patterns in those numbers. We believe that we can do a couple of things. We can come up with some metrics that can be fed by this type of data, which was never available, but we can also correlate these measures with some of the existing ones so that we can still say, okay, that 58% means a level of service B or a level of service of whatever it might be. But what we also have to do is get this out into conversations with the different audiences, and what we also have to do is not just talk in our own traffic engineering silo. We need to talk and kind of cross-pollinate with all these others. And then the other last point that I'll make is even kind of a pitch, in that so much data and information is being blasted at us like a fire hose, but at the end of it still, there's a human. There's somebody at that console, there's someone like me, there's people who have to do something with this data. And now the data is so intense and pervasive that it has the potential to totally overwhelm someone and not even give them an opportunity or the desire to start acting on it. So we really have to address this human side of using the data. And I'm sure that dilemma doesn't just exist in transportation and traffic. It exists in all fields, but we got to pay attention to how the humans act on this.
I think for us, the game-changing thing is arterials. Because to train a neural network based on
behavior,
you've got to have good data about the behavior. And we have really good freeway data based on speed sensors.
Freeways. We don't have good data about
the arterials. So thinking of connected vehicles as virtual sensors
gives us that fidelity to be able to do that. And do it really
quite accurately.
We're seeing really good correlation with one or two data points on a corridor and pretty broad positioning of what's really going on. So that then leads to the ability to do things like
impact analysis,
the whole butterfly effect, right? Someone crashes their car in a particular location and all the cars spread off in all sorts of different directions. What's that going to do to the traffic everywhere? You can't even begin to model that without having pretty good understanding of the flow, and you need the vehicle perspective of the flows to be able to do that.
Great. Awesome, guys. Well, thank you so much, all three of you, for taking your time. Awesome session. I think we've got another one coming up here shortly. I can't even remember which one it is. Oh, it's lunch. We're going to go to lunch now. So appreciate your guys' time. Thank you.